back to the Generation Y Conservative Show. I am glad that you could join me tonight. Listen, before we get started here and I tell you about this half-hour sponsors, one thing I didn't mention before is that you can actually find the Generation Y Conservative Show on your social media platforms. Find me on Facebook. Just search for the Generation Y Conservative. Hit like and follow along. It's also important that you go to the YouTube channel where people like me are getting demonetized all the time. Just search for, under channels, the Generation Y Conservative. Hit subscribe and hit that bell for notifications. We put all the show on there, including split up into segments. We also do movie reviews on there and a couple other things that may be happening over the summer, as well as our firearm spotlight reviews. You can also follow along with me on Twitter at Gen Y Conservative without the E on the end. And of course, listen to me here on Mojo 5.0 on Sundays from 5 to 7. So this half hour is brought to you by Riduzone. I think you guys probably hear a lot about Riduzone on Mojo, but it says summer is almost here, guys. It is. It is too hot for my weight right now, and we're only in spring. And I work outside on a roof. Doesn't exactly fit the profile of an overweight person. pools, beach, lakes, shorts, and outdoors. You have to have time to jumpstart your weight loss plan in time to look good in that new bathing suit or summer dress. I could go with the bathing suit. I don't know if I would look good in a summer dress, but maybe Riduzone can help me out with that as well. Here's your answer. It is Riduzone. It's America's first weight management supplement of OEA, which is a natural metabolite of olive oil, which is produced in the human body. And if you're Italian like me, or at least 9% Italian, there's a lot more olive oil flowing through those blood veins than you would think. Riduzone is a formulation of OEA to aid healthy weight loss, safe and FDA accepted by the Food and Drug Administration. Riduzone supports healthy weight, low-calorie consumption, and efficient metabolism of body fat. It is also safe. It's a non-stimulant, naturally present in the body. Sorry, I'm stumbling there. Vegetarian, gluten-free, and non-GMO. Patented, and as I said before, FDA-accepted supplement. Don't delay any longer. What can you do? You can go check it out at Riduzone.com. That's Riduzone. And when you order, you will receive a special 30% off coupon automatically applied to your 3-bottle per month for 3-month supply. That's Riduzone.com. Riduzone. Get in the zone. Oh, that's the wrong zone. Sorry about that. Also, this half hour is brought to you by Cat Coolers. Speaking of getting ready for summer and everything, Cat Coolers is a company that you really need to look into. Coolers are the cool thing, right? Everybody has these really interesting coolers that are out there, except some of the big cooler companies I know personally are involved with some anti-Second Amendment causes. They're involved with some other causes that you may not agree with. But Cat Coolers is an advertiser on this station, which probably should tell you something. They're rugged, they keep ice cold for up to 7 days, they're customizable, and they come in 4 different color risks, I guess you could say. White, black, yellow, and camouflage. That's where my confusion on color comes in. Listen, they apparently haven't set up my code yet. So my code was supposed to be my dog's name, which is Liberty, which just goes to show you I kind of like politics a little bit. But listen, there's no code for that available yet, or at least I haven't been told. But listen, my guys over at Defenders Live who helped me get onto the station are on here. So use the code Steven. That would be a good one. Just go to catcoolers.com. It's CatCoolers.com. Enter your code Steven for a 10% discount on your cooler. Get ready for summer. It's coming. Whether you're a water drinker, soda drinker, beer drinker, if you want vodka and Red Bull in there and you want to invite me over for a barbecue with some of the nostalgia stuff, like, I am available. All I'm saying, that's all I'm saying, is I am available for that, okay? Okay, we were talking about some entertainment topics before. We actually have a couple more, and it will we're going to kind of transition, I guess you could say, from entertainment into politics as well, because one of them is kind of a crossover of that. But first, we're going to talk about Alyssa Milano picking a fight with Wendy's. Wendy, the chain restaurant, if you thought I was talking about specific Wendy. I don't even know any Wendy's anymore. Wendy's. Yes, it says, Alyssa Milano tries picking a fight with Wendy's over spicy chicken nuggets, and now we're dead. This is according to Twitchy.com. Wendy's put up a post that said, y'all keep asking... Chance the Rapper. This was in response to Chance the Rapper. Chance the Rapper tweeted positive affirmations for today. I will have a good day. I will succeed today. Wendy's will bring back spicy nuggets at some point. Please, please, Lord, let it be today. I could have gotten a little bit more gospel-y behind that. Wendy said in a tweet, y'all keep asking, so here's your chance. The people in charge say if you guys can get our tweet, this one right here, to 2 million likes, they will bring back spicy chicken nuggets. Let's freaking do this. Well, Alyssa Milano, Little Miss Social Justice Warrior, who couldn't leave it at Who's the Boss and Charmed. You know, when you have good looks and you had a great career with what you had, just leave it at that instead of getting involved in all this stuff. How about this, her tweet to at Chance the Rapper. Did you know Wendy's is the only fast food chain refusing to protect farm worker women from sexual assault and rape in the fields? Message for the people in charge. Instead of spicy nuggets, we want food that is harvested with dignity, not violence. Hashtag boycott Wendy's. She also went on, more info, Wendy's refuses to join program protecting farm workers from sexual abuse, according to thinkprogress.com. What an unbiased website. Hashtag boycott Wendy's. Well, a lot of people did not take too kindly to Wendy's being attacked, obviously. Some people responded on Twitter. This according to Jen A. Sorry, at Chance the Rapper, you are not allowed to like at Wendy's spicy chicken nuggets. Alyssa Milano said so. This is Reux. Let the guy eat his chicken nuggets in peace. Gotti. Oh man, you got away with Gotti, huh? He just wants some freaking nuggets. Gosh. How about the people's champ? Leave Chance alone. You said it isn't about policy, right? Where are the ROA producers when I need the tape rolled back on dad ass? Girl, bye. Let me know when Who's the Boss reruns are back on. Exactly what I was saying. This is according to a guy named Craig. You pick some of the strangest fights. Just chill. And then this last one here, it was showing, what is it here? Oh, yeah. So, little investigative journalism on the part of Twitchy, by the way. They went back and found a tweet from Wendy's recognizing Alyssa Milano way back in 2011 that says, thanks, at Alyssa Milano, for tweeting about our 50-cent donation to kids in foster care for each Frosty purchased this weekend. So it looks like Alyssa Milano has actually praised Wendy's in the past. Go figure. How about this one? We're going to go to George Clooney, who obviously wants to pick a fight, along with Jimmy Kimmel, who featured him on the Jimmy Kimmel Show, with basically everyone. Let's take a look at the clip and see what the great George Clooney had to say.
Hi, I'm actor, director, and two-time sexiest man alive, George Clooney. Science has given us unprecedented knowledge of the natural world, from subatomic particles to the majesty of space. Science enables us to cure diseases, to communicate across great distances, even to fly. Tragically, though, the volumes of invaluable knowledge gathered over centuries are now threatened by an epidemic of dumb idiots saying dumb.
You know what this is? It's a snowball. So it's very, very cold out.
Dumb is highly contagious, infecting the minds of even the most stable geniuses.
If you have a windmill anywhere near your house, they say the noise causes cancer. You tell me that one, okay?
Wow. As a result, rampant dumb now threatens our health, our security, and our planet. Fortunately, there is hope. At United to defeat untruthful misinformation and support science. You dumbass. Your generous contribution to You Dumbass will provide desperately needed knowledge to dumb idiots on Facebook and Twitter all around the world. Just $20 will convince one idiot that climate change is real. 50 will teach five brainless dumb to vaccinate their kids. And 200 will teach 10 knuckle draggers that dinosaurs existed, but not at the same time as people. Together, we can win the fight against dumbness. But we can't do it alone. Call this number today. Operators are standing by. Don't be an idiot. The world needs your support. You dumbass.
George Clooney and Jimmy Kimmel are really, really good actors reading off of scripts. What you find a lot of times, though, is when they go off script, they don't know jack crap. Right? This message is attacking multiple fronts. In one regard, it's going after climate change. They used a clip of a senator, I guess it was, or a representative doing something with a snowball, which did look stupid, whatever. It also had a little video of Donald Trump talking about windmills, and they obviously chopped up the clip, and it seems like they took it out of context. And it looked like, to me, the second time I watched it, like he was actually talking about making fun of someone saying that the noise from windmills causes cancer, and they make it seem like he's the one that's saying that. So I thought that was pretty interesting and typical of people like George Clooney and Jimmy Kimmel to chop up things to make that seem like that's what they're trying to go with. But when you take these people out of their characters that they play on TV, mirror images of themselves and their social justice warrior mentalities, you find that they probably can't sit down with a professional skeptic of what they're talking about and answer basic, simple questions, right? I would actually point George Clooney in regards to the dinosaur question, which to me a couple years ago would have sounded crazy as well. Go talk to Dr. Jason Lyle, a scientist that has some really interesting ways of looking at that. And I would encourage everyone to go look up Dr. Jason Lyle on the internet and talking about astronomy, creation, and mathematics. And what was the other one? I forget. But really interesting things. And it's a matter of asking questions, right? It's almost like we're to the point now where asking questions is discouraged and you should just toe the line. So they make fun of people that aren't going with scientists that they agree with, and that we're supposed to just go, oh, okay, all right, I guess you're a professional, what you say goes, even though science is an ever-changing field. So science is really one of those only fields that gets away with that. And anytime something changes and they update it, like anything nutritional, salt is good, salt is bad, butter's good, butter's bad, like back and forth, they get to say that new research shows this. And they never say that they were wrong. It's just that new details have emerged and that they've found a new study, and that through this new thing that we've discovered that we weren't wrong. It's just that we need to mold our opinion to be completely the opposite of what we were thinking before. Global cooling, global warming, global cooling, global warming, climate change, right? All these types of things. So George Clooney should really sit down with someone like the founder of the Weather Channel and really answer some basic questions. How about the fact that we have gone in and out of multiple ice ages, according to the scientists that you're quoting, with going in and out prior to the Industrial Revolution? So what brought us in, what specifically brought us out of the ice ages, and what brought us back into the ice ages? it's a cyclical environmental movement based on the rotation of the Earth, the wobble of the Earth on the axis. It's the rotation of the Earth around the Sun in an elliptical fashion. It's the rotation of the Moon around the Earth at different... whatever. It's the rotation of the Moon around the Earth causing different things as well. And the whole balance of the galaxy that we're in, right? It's not something that happens. And then you have sun flares that flare out and go and do wacky things too. And they expect us to think that if we spend trillions upon trillions of dollars that we can effectively change climate by less than a degree and that that's going to be what helps, right? When all the data seems to show that when you look back, that data for scientists has been allowed to be skewed by 1 degree in either direction for margin of error in the past and in the present for future predictions, which means that if we've warmed a degree, and that's so important, I think it was actually, I'll correct myself, I think they were allowed to adjust for error within half a degree. Well, a half a degree difference on either end would equal a degree. And if we're talking about the drastic change over the last century of an increase by a degree, that falls within the margin of error of what you could be estimating in the wrong direction on either end. So it's simple questions like these. How about the temperature shed report that came out where they put these sheds for temperature gauges all over the place to measure temperatures and increases under strict conditions? And then some guy goes out and does an investigation of how these are maintained and how they've held up over the years and go to find them painted all different colors near mechanical instruments or air conditioning units and everything that throw off heat, and that these temperatures are fluctuating all over the place. And this is what they've been using for data. There's so many questions that people like George Clooney aren't willing to sit down and acknowledge because they're so invested in their agenda that they don't want to hear these types of things. And there's plenty of skeptics out there that are willing to talk about how we can really conserve what God gave us on Earth. I think there's two different topics there that people fail to recognize. There's a lot of us, myself included, that get absolutely disgusted when we see the amount of trash that's floating around in oceans, in lakes, in riverways and everything. Because we don't believe in the fear-mongering aspect of global warming, that it's all human-related, they want to equate that and tie into that we love polluting, right? I don't love polluting. I don't love seeing that trash floating around in all these waterways and everything. I think it's disgusting. I think we need to take care of what God gave us. But that has nothing to do with global warming. It has to do with taking care of the environment that has been entrusted to us as people. And those two things get conflated all the time. Also, they talk about vaccinations. Now, funny enough, I have people that specifically watch this podcast that I'm friends with that talk about vaccinations with people, saying that if you don't vaccinate your kids, you can unfriend me. Well, I'll tell you something else in regards to that. Number one, we don't vaccinate our kids. And there's a lot more that goes into that than talking about autism being connected to vaccinations. I'm not the one to make that argument. I wouldn't make that argument. I have a lot more concerns out there than the autism aspect of it. And I think that the autism spectrum is something that is never talked about by people who want to blast anti-vaxxers. They want to say that they believe that vaccinations cause autism, when really autism is a spectrum of somewhere between 8 and 12 different types of symptoms. And if you check off a certain number of those, then you're considered autistic on a wider spectrum. And that really ranges all the way up to Asperger's and all this other stuff. And when you look at that spectrum, vaccines, some of the side effects of vaccines cause some of those symptoms that could be checked off to add up to be autism. So I'm not saying that a vaccine can cause autism. I'm saying that a mix according to the different biological makeup of a bunch of people, could add up to a bunch of vaccines causing check marks on all those things and adding up to a spectrum. But beyond that, I don't agree with aborted fetuses being involved in vaccines. I think that we could get away with some stem cell stuff and replacements of that. And I also don't agree with the numbers game, right? The majority of the things that we vaccinate for in this country are curable in the United States, whereas the side effects that definitely go along with the vaccines are risks that you take, right? So it's a numbers game. I'm not saying that you shouldn't vaccinate your kids. That's a decision up to you, which opens up a whole other thing in regards to libertarian ideas. You know, you can't, it's hard to make the argument that it's hard to make the argument all over the place, right? You can't sit there and tell us that you're for women, that you can't touch a woman's body in regards to abortion and tell her what to do with her body, but then say that you have to, you should be able to force people to inject different chemicals and things into their bodies, right? On the other end, you can't be, it's just all over the place. Honestly, I'm a little fried from work this week, but what I will tell you is I don't care what you do. Do whatever you want in your family. Do what you feel is best for your family. But don't be a prick to everyone else just because they don't want to inject different chemicals into their kids for something that is curable in the United States. Okay? Point being. Anyway, let's move on here to another topic with Meghan McCain showing up on Seth Meyers' late night show and what she had to say in regards to him attacking her on Representative Illhan Omar. And I have some stuff to talk about this one then. So let's hear what Meghan McCain had to say on Seth Meyers' show.
I want to ask about Illhan Omar, Congresswoman from Minnesota. You know, she was in a situation, you were very vocal about some of her tweets. People were upset, thought it was anti-Semitic language. She has since unequivocally apologized for them. And then after that, there was this tragic synagogue shooting in California, and you once again sort of, on a Sunday show, a Sunday news show, brought up her tweets again in the context of that shooting.
On George Stephanopoulos.
On George Stephanopoulos, yeah. And I just wonder, because I do think it's fairly dangerous, and you brought it up after Congresswoman Omar had also had some death threats against her. Do you think, you know, she's obviously now stated she needs to be more careful with her language. Don't you think other people who talk about her need to be a little bit more thoughtful as well? Or do you stand by those comments of tying her to this, her rhetoric to the synagogue shooting?
I don't think I tied her to it in particular. I think that I'm calling out what I see as anti-Semitic language, and when you're talking about
But even after,
hypnotic...
you called it out after she'd apologized for it. I do want to establish the timeline.
I think that Democrats are hedging on this, and I think it's very dangerous, and I think Chuck Schumer and I are in alignment about Israel's stance in geopolitical politics. I think it's of the utmost importance, and I think she is bringing her party to the extremism on this, and I think we have to look to Europe and what's happening over there, and that they're, you know, in the British politics, anti-Semitism is very common, and I see it happening over there, and I worry about it happening over here. I stand by every single thing I've said, and if that makes me unpopular in this room or in front of you, so be it.
Well, I don't. See, that's a weird thing that you would take the position of trying to be unpopular. Here I am trying to, you know, find the common ground on this because I do think one of the, I think we could both agree.
Were you bothered by her language about 9/11?
I thought it was taken out of context, and I think if you watch that whole
speech.
Would
you give President Trump the same leverage if he had said the same thing?
Well, I would say that Donald Trump is certainly in no position to criticize her language on 9/11 based on the things that he said about 9/11, right?
But would you give... I just think you have to give people the same credence, and I think...
Well, I
would,
let me make the clarification between Donald Trump and Ilhan Omar is one of them has apologized and said they're going to try to do better, and they're going to be educated by people who know about this. That's what she said, and I think she... You know, it's an interesting thing when we have two Muslim women for the first time. They do have a different perspective on things. And I think when we talk about the idea of, like, let's all try to meet in the middle on things, we have to listen to other people's perspective. And
oh, I agree. I work on The View with Joy Behar every day. I listen to other perspectives all day.
Is there
long.
A way for people to talk about differences in Israeli policy without getting framed as anti-Semitic language?
Yeah, I just think you can't talk about Jews hypnotizing the world, talking about all about the Benjamins.
You do keep bringing up the two tweets that she's apologized for, and I think that's a little unfair to her, especially because we've established...
Are you her publicist?
What?
Are you her press person?
No, I'm just someone who cares about the fact that there's someone out there who is in a minority who has had death threats against her, and I think that we should all use the same language that you're asking her to be careful about her language, and I would ask everybody else to be careful about theirs.
Okay. All right. I mean, I'm not sure what would make you happy coming out of my mouth right now? I'm genuinely curious.
I'm perfectly happy with everything that's coming out of my mouth, and I like that we spent this time together.
Okay. You seem a little, I mean, I think, you know, my opinions are very strong, and I think sometimes because
that is coming across. I do want you to know that.
But, well, I'm on a network show.
Yeah.
I'm on ABC, and I think sometimes when you're a hardcore conservative woman like I am, mm-hmm. I think sometimes it's daunting. I'm not on Fox News anymore. I'm on ABC. And I think sometimes my beliefs, even though I do believe I represent the vast majority of people in red states, or at least a lot of women in the middle of the country who are pro-life, pro-NRA, you know, but, you know, strong foreign policy hawks, people who believe in limited and small government, I think that sometimes it tends to be jarring for people to see someone like me in mainstream news and not on Fox.
Okay, so number one. We have to pick this apart because Seth Meyers is completely off the rails on this, and I think Meghan McCain kind of put him into a box that he belonged into on this, which is, you know, he keeps talking about how it's unfair for Representative Illhan Omar to be put into this position where people are attacking her and giving her death threats and everything, which is not good, by the way. I don't condone that kind of behavior. But would she... is a good question, have apologized for saying these anti-Semitic remarks had she not been called out by people like Meghan McCain, right? And realized that in between these remarks, she made apologies in between and was basically saying that this wouldn't happen again and then continued to make anti-Semitic remarks. Also, she hasn't been very forthcoming, Illhan Omar, in what she's been doing. I mean, she's made anti-Semitic remarks over and over and over again, along with the other Muslim representative as well, and AOC. And the Democratic Party is having a real problem with it. But not only that, the Republican side of voters and some people are actually having a big problem with it too. I received a message in my Facebook inbox of someone that was going off on Jews for being the problem or the actual... you know, source of the problem for one of the topics. I said, don't message me again. I'm blocking you because it's just ridiculous, this kind of crap that's coming out of your mouth. You know, Seth Meyers here wants to look at Illhan Omar's religion as being under attack as a minority, which is, that's not a minority at all in the world. It's clear and simply not. And right now, the biggest religion under assault is Christianity. So I just think Seth Meyers is way off base here. But listen, we're going to talk about more politics when we get back. Stay tuned after these commercials.